Hello, everybody. Welcome to Intermediate Accounting 17th Edition Video Solution Walkthrough Exercise 2-10. This is taken from the Intermediate Accounting 17th Edition textbook. Authors are Don Kiso, Jerry Weingan, and Terry Warfield. The question used in the presentation is copyright 2019 by John Wiley and Sons. All rights are reserved for educational purposes only. The video may not be distributed or redistributed without the express permission of Wiley. The solution presentation is copyright 2019 to 2021 by Bennett Tchaikovsky. All rights are reserved. The opinions contained within this presentation are those of Bennett Tchaikovsky and not the authors of the textbook or Wiley. One comment that I do want to make to you is that since we're now kind of dealing with the theory of accounting, you're going to have different opinions. So my opinions in this may differ than what Wiley has, and that's fine, right? But when we're going through and answering these types of questions, what we're really going to be wanting to do is referring back to what I call the accounting inverted pyramid. And then also over here, like a little bit more about the qualitative characteristics over here. So let's just go ahead and look at this. So depreciation expense on the building for the year was $60,000 because the building was increasing in value during the year. The controller decided to change the depreciation expense to retained earnings instead of to net income. The following entry is recorded. Now, you cannot make a direct entry over here to retain earnings. If you have an expense, it has to go on the income statement. Now, ultimately, this will be shown as a, you are going to close out depreciation expense ultimately to retain earnings, but you don't debit retained earnings, you know, for directly for the amount of the depreciation expense. And when it comes to a building, this is for Kramer Inc., when it comes to a building, we cannot arbitrarily increase the value of the asset. In fact, with equipment, you're generally, you know, just going to be impairing it. You can't say it's appreciated in value. There's some exceptions to that. If there's an asset held for sale, you can have a situation where if I'm holding an asset for sale and I've written it down, I can potentially recapture part of that write down, but you're generally never going to go through and do that. So you've got to record it as an expense. It will get closed out to retain earnings, but I don't really understand why, if it was increasing in value, this is not really how you go about doing it. Okay, letter B. Materials were purchased on January 1st, 2020 for $120,000, and this amount was entered in the materials account. On December 31st, materials would have cost $141, so the following entry is made. No, you're showing inventory at the lower of cost or market. We do not arbitrarily write up the value of materials, right? You're going to have potentially lower cost of goods sold, so you're going to have more of a profit, but you're not going to write up the value of your merchandise. So you just can't do it. You're not going to recognize a gain on inventory until it's sold. That's not even a gain, it's sales revenue. Okay, during the year, the company purchased equipment through the issuance of common stock. The stock had a par value of $135,000. Boy, that's a big problem. And why? Because with par value, it's traditionally set at a fraction of a penny. Even if you want to just kind of take a look at Tesla, when you look at Tesla's common stock, right, par value is going to be 0.001. You would never have something where you'd have a par value of 135,000. So that's in of itself, that's a problem. So I got a par value and the fair value of 450. The fair value of the equipment was not easily determinable. The company recorded this transaction as follows. It is recorded at par. So what you have to do, if you cannot determine the value of the equipment, you go with the fair value of what you exchanged it for. So if the stock is more easily determinable than the equipment, then you'd have to show it at 450. This is, you know, par value is an arbitrary amount that's used to reflect the minimum liability that a shareholder has to the corporation. It's always shown at a fraction of a penny, unless you're Warren Buffett and Berkshire Hathaway, where it's $5. But if you're Berkshire Hathaway and you have a 400, $400,000 price per share, dude, go have a $5 par value all day. So again, the par value is not the way you do it. You do it with a fair value. And if I bought equipment and I issued common stock, I would basically have debit equipment for 450, common stock par, additional paid in capital common stock. Okay. So during the year, the company sold certain equipment for 285, recognizing a gain of 69 because the controller believed that the new equipment would be needed in the near future. She decided to defer the gain and amortize it over the life of any new equipment purchase. Now you got to recognize the gain. You know, there's certain rules for when we get to non-cash exchanges, which is in chapter 10. There are certain rules for equipment that you can defer a gain. Okay. But if you sold it and I got a gain of 69,000, because the controller believed that it, now you got to recognize the gain. You cannot defer that gain. So it, just you sell it, you recognize the gain, the gain's going to go in other income. Okay. So an order for 61.5 has been received from a customer for products on hand. The order was shipped on January 9th. Oh, bill and hold. January 9th, 2021, the company made the following entry in 2020. Okay, so here's the problem. They didn't complete the sale, okay, until the items were shipped. Okay, even if you had it free on board destination or free on board shipping point, the goods were not shipped until 2021. You do not make any, you do not need to do anything here. Now, the other problem is too, is that they're not even recording cost of goods sold. So we don't do anything in 2020. And you're also missing the cost of goods sold, or maybe I cut it off on the question, but it's like, you're also missing the cost of goods sold portion of this. So, but you don't do it because it's 2020. I didn't ship it until 2021. So the earliest I could recognize this is on January 9th. When you're in public accounting, what you're going to be doing is something called cutoff testing. And you're going to be doing cutoff testing for sales, mainly for sales, for revenue, because it's a hot topic. So you're going to be doing that for sales as well as a few other different things. So again, I'm just going to keep that in the back of your mind. So that is exercise 2-10. I want to thank Wiley for allowing me to use their text. And please do not forget to like and subscribe. If you need other solutions, just ask in the comments. Look forward to seeing you on the next video. Have a great day.